Look at these little guys. Many of you might never have seen such worms before, but they're all around us. My colleagues and I have been observing these fascinating little creatures for many long hours in the lab. Recently, we bundled together over 4 years of work to write a research paper which has now been published in the academic journal PLOS Biology. So let me tell you a bit more about this. The central player in this story is a worm that can be found almost anywhere on the planet, as it likes to live in compost. This little worm, known as C. elegans, can barely be seen by the naked eye. We chose to take a closer look at this little creature because it is completely transparent, and so you can easily follow how it develops. In fact, it develops so fast that within half a day you can see a fertilized egg cell change into a little larvae. This feature of the worm appealed to us because we were interested in studying a very basic process in biology, cell division. When a cell divides, it forms two daughter cells. But how does it make sure it passes on its genetic content, also known as DNA, in such a way that both cells will end up exactly the same? For an animal to develop correctly, this process needs to be controlled very carefully. In most species, including ourselves, but also in the worm, the DNA holds the information for making a specific protein, the so-called centromere protein, which sits on the DNA and makes sure it's separated correctly during division. A specific part of this protein, the tail region, is important, as it acts as a guide to help the protein find its right location on the DNA to perform its function. We decided to study this protein tail in the worm because we can easily sabotage it. We used a genetic technique to erase the tail region. What we expected to see was that removing this guiding tail would prevent the protein from finding its right location. This would then lead to the incorrect separation of the DNA during cell division, or in other words, the eggs would stop developing into worms. However, we were in for quite a surprise. We found that the first generation of worms missing the protein tail, aka the guide, developed normally, because the tailless protein somehow managed to find its way to the right locations on the DNA. It was only in their offspring, so the second generation, that the protein failed to localize correctly, which meant that this generation didn't grow up. So here was a puzzle. The first generation without the protein tail lives, but the second generation dies? Neither of them has the guiding tail. So what can explain the difference? Perhaps the difference lies in who the parent was. Taking you back to this picture, it seems that the generation whose parents have the normal copy of the protein, and therefore the guide, are fine. The parent seems to be able to give the tailless protein instructions on how to find its right location in this generation of worms. This is, however, not the case for the generation that follows. Their parents do not provide these instructions, which is why the second generation fails to develop. Perhaps think of it like this. Imagine a parent reading to its child. It's hardly ever only what's written which makes the story. It's often the added details, like the character voices, that stick with you. Now think of DNA as a book with instructions. For the offspring to be able to divide their cells, they don't only need the book itself, but also the little details added by the parent. The first generation grows up because their parents provided these details. Apparently, this generation eventually forgets and fails to pass on this crucial information to their children, which is why the second generation doesn't develop. Finding something like this, inheritance not just through the DNA, but through something on top of DNA, places our story in the realm of epigenetics, an exciting field of biology. We've now uncovered an epigenetic mechanism in the worm which revolves around the very basic process of cell division. Perhaps a similar mechanism exists in many different living organisms, which really makes us want to fully understand this process in the worm. If you want more details about all that we've found so far, check out the full story, which is now freely available on the PLOS Biology website. Also, follow our lab Twitter page for the latest developments.